Welcome to My Life, Chassidus Applied, episode 81. Beginning with wishes to everyone for Aksiv v'Chassim Ateva, as is customary to say and wish each other in the month of Elul. This episode is dedicated in loving memory of Rafael Yitzchok Efraim ben Aryeh Leib Shlomo, Rafi Estrin upon his 17th yahrzeit, which is today the 8th of Elul, by his loving parents, Freda and Leib Estrin. May his neshama be enriched by our learning together, our discussions together, and may the family only know simchas, and may we all only know simchas, begoli, beteva, nirva, nigla. Well, this will be a pretty diverse episode to follow up some of the discussions that I began last week about mental illness, mental health, and delving deeper into it, as well as some new topics. The questions keep coming in, thank God. Not thank God for the problems, but thank God for the communication. I feel it to be very healthy interaction when there's a back and forth of this nature. And it just continues to amaze us all that everybody's so open and so direct, both in describing issues as well as critique and comments and so on. So please, I invite you all to participate in any way, which way you can, wish, anonymously submitting any question you like. Everything is allowed at meaningfullife.com/mylife. With that, we'll begin, as as the custom, with a timely few words about the period in which we are in. As I said, we're in the month of Elul, which is rich with all types of messages and lessons, especially in our psychological and emotional and personal lives. Chassidus takes the month of El, Anila Deidi V'Deidi Li, a month of love and relationships, and turns it into a blueprint for our own relationships, for building healthy lives, both emotionally, psychologically, spiritually, both in our relationship with each other and our relationship with God. Being that the end of this week is Yud Gimel El, which will be the anniversary, Friedrich Rebbe's wedding in Tofresh Nun Zayin, when he was 17 years old, with the Rebbe's in Chamedina, as well as Shabbos being Parshas Ki Seitzei. So let me say a few words about that. You probably all know the history that the Rebbe Rashab struggled for a number of years with the question, should he open up a yeshiva? Because until the Rebbe Rashab, there was no yeshivas temchit mimim. There was the children or the students would go to other yeshivas. The Alter Rebbe had a chederishin, a chedersheni. Those were for the iluim, those were for ge'inim, with all kinds of conditions. But where did the children of Chabad Chassidim go to? They went to the different schools that existed in Russia and other places in the vicinity, and there was no Chabad yeshiva until the Rebbe Rashab. There was yeshivim during the time of the Rebbe Marash, but a formal yeshiva, where students would be study Chassidus and Nigla, and be trained in the method of Chassidus Chabad, began in Tofresh Nun Zayin, which in the equivalent of that is 1897. Began in the month of Elul, corresponding to the time when the Friedrich Rebbe got married. The Friedrich Rebbe's wedding was Yud Gimel Elul. That year was also Friday, as this year. Tezvav Elul was the Isyazdus of the yeshiva, and Chai Elul was the opening of the yeshiva. As is written up in all the in the history, as the Friedrich Rebbe describes it in detail. Why was the Rebbe Rashab struggling with it? Because since his father, his grandfather, his great-grandfather, and his great-great-grandfather, meaning the Alter Rebbe, the Mittler Rebbe, the Tzaddik Rebbe Marash, did not open a yeshiva, it was a big thing to do, to start something that was not unprecedented. But then he explains, he writes the whole mission statement of the yeshiva in Kuntres Etz Chaim, which was a kuntres that came out in that period of time, as well as in Tofres Samach Aleph, Simchas Torah, the Rebbe Rashab gave the famous sikha called the Kol HaYetzel Mechamez Beis David, which means all those that go out to the war of the house of David, Kesvin Get Krisis L'Ishtei, and a discussion as well of what the role of the Tafke, the purpose of these yeshiva students are. And essentially it was, as he makes it clear there, not just to open another yeshiva, because there was plenty of Teiri yeshivas, but to create soldiers, create people who would stand on the front line with Torah, armed with Nigla and Chassidus, to be able to deal with the challenges that were coming in the 20th century. and it's amazingly the prescience of the Rebbe Rashab, that this was 1901, you're talking about that Sicha Tofres Samach Aleph, the 1900th, the Yeshiva 1897. The Russian Revolution had not happened yet. World War I did not happen yet. World War II did not happen yet. All the changes that would take place that we are living in today didn't exist yet, and yet he anticipated. And as such, essentially created a training academy, if you want to put it that way, called Temchit Mimim, with all the explanations that he discusses there in detail. And he connected it to the marriage of his son, the Friedrich Rebbe, who would, of course, become the Menahel of the yeshiva, and then the Rebbe afterwards, after Tofresh Pei, and as it passed on to the seventh generation, our Rebbe. All to prepare a generation to deal with the challenges that would be coming and that are existing today. So it's not a small matter to look at these events of Yud Gimel El, Tezvav El, Chai El, and so on of that year, because it's relevant today, because that is what the seeds were planted for what we're doing today. And that is taking Chassidus and applying it to the challenges of our times, to the challenges of life, individually, collectively, communally, and so on, as he explains in that Sikh in Samach Aleph, Charfu Igvus Meshichecha, and the different challenges that would exist in that period of time. In a more specific way, when the Rebbe Rashab, when the Friedrich Rebbe's marriage, we know there's the famous Hemshech, Samach to Samach Tofresh Nun Zayin, one of the fundamental Chassidic discourses that the Rebbe Rashab delivered over a period of the Sheva Brachas, with many more Maimorim as well during that period in time, all printed in Sefer Maimorim Tofresh Nun Zayin. Samach to Samach came out as a separate booklet, but now it's all combined there together, and you can learn it. But one brief nekuda that he talks a lot about there is the power of simcha, peretz geder. Whatever you see in the sichas, the concept of simcha, peretz geder, that simcha can transcend, can breach all impediments, geder, every wall, every fence, every gate, everything that blocks us, that's rooted in samach to samach tofresh nun zayin. The power to break through joy, that reaches even deeper than tainug in some ways, which of course a fundamental principle in the Rebbe Sichas in later years. We spoke about in the years in Tavshinun Aleph about how Simcha can be the last step in bringing the Geula. Simcha is not just dancing and singing. Simcha is a Simchas HaNefesh, a Simchas HaChayim, a type of inner satisfaction that expresses itself in a revealed way that is a key to all health. When a person has a Simcha Dika attitude to anything, they can overcome any challenge. Because despite beyond every challenge that we have is also our attitude to it, as is an unrecurring theme that we talk about here in my life, Chassidus Applied, the attitude that you have. And a Simcha Dika attitude means an upbeat one based on betoch and based on trust and faith that we can deal with any given situation. And as I said, that was the time when the yeshiva was misnisyased, that was the time of the wedding. So that is one key point. The Rebbe explains in the context of Kiseitzei, which of course the question begs when you read the pasuk Kiseitzei l'mochama alevecha, the expression, it should say Kisilcham. We know the Torah is brief, and it's known for its brevity and its precision. Why Kiseitzei l'mochama, an extra word, say Kisilcham imeivecha? When you will wage war, Kiseitzei, you'll go out to wage war. And then alevecha, it should say be'evecha, imeivecha, with your enemy. Different expressions in Hebrew for that. What's alevecha? And the one answers both the questions. Because every war that is fought is never within you. It's a war outside of you. So Kiseitzei, you go out of your own inner domain. You fight the war because we live in a hostile world. We live in a world where we have battles, whether it's internal psychological battles like the Nefesh HaBahamis, the animal soul, with our own selfishness, with our own temptations and vices and so on, or wars that are waged literally with others. All those wars, we have to know, is not about you. It's outside of who you are. Neshamesh anasata bitahedihi. Your soul is pure. Always remains so. Remains intact. Every battle that's fought is outside of your domain. Even when you fight inner battles, internal battles, that's also not the real you. The real you is a divine soul created in the image of God that has the capacity to achieve everything that it needs to achieve. And the Nefesh HaBahamis, like the Rambam paskens in Sof Hilchus Gerish and Sof Perek Beis, the end of chapter 2, when he talks about that you force someone until they say, I want. What kind of want have you forced somebody to say, I want? That's not really wanting. So he says, no. The forcing is to eliminate the Yetzer Hara is the one that forces him not to be his natural self. Because every Jew wants to do Torah and Mitzvahs and wants to avoid and refrain from anything that's opposite of what's divine. Think of it this way. It's not just because Torah and Mitzvahs, it's because that's the way we were created to be. As I've mentioned a number of times, a healthy person would never put their hand in fire. If you see someone putting their hand in fire, God forbid, they either don't know it's fire or they don't know that fire burns. So if we are able to do something that causes damage to ourselves, in the spiritual sense of the word, it's because we're not aware that it's causing damage. Or we don't feel the damage, which is the case. How could we hurt another person, as the Yerushalmi says, when the fact is that we're all part of one organism? How could one hand hurt another hand? Because we don't feel it. The Tzimtzum HaRishon took care of that. That created a sense, an illusion of separation from one another. But in truth, that's why Nichnas Beiruach Shtus is required for there to be an Aveda, which means displacement. Aveda from the word moving away. Mitzvah is a connection, a healthy connection. Aveda is a displacement, a dissonance. And that is something we would not do unless we didn't feel it. We didn't feel its effect. So who you are is connected. A healthy child that was born in a world that is consistently and relentlessly attacking our inner peace. But when you go to wage war, always know it's kiseitze, it's outside of who you are. And alevecha, you always remain above, because you are not a warrior. You fight, but that's not what defines you. What defines you is your mission in life. If that's what's necessary, at times to fight, that's what you do. But that's not what defines you. And that alone is the secret to success. As the Rebbe brings often the custom that some armies had, that when they went out to wage war, even before they began, they would sing a victory song. They haven't even fought the first battle, because it's the confidence. It's knowing, as we do before we go into Rosh Hashanah, why do we wear white? So the Tur writes, because they know the personality of God. We know that we will definitely be victorious in din. In the olden days, they wore black when they were concerned that they'd be guilty, and white when you're innocent. But how do we wear white before we even start Yom HaDin? Because we're confident and convinced that we'll be zeichem b'din, that we'll definitely be victorious. It's an attitude, a mindset, that when you go in with that type of attitude, that it's impossible that you won't be victorious. That alone is a critical component in victory. Not to be, in other words, affected by and drawn down by the challenges. To know their challenges, but their seitzei, yitzia, you have to go outside of yourself. And it's alei vecha. And in Tafresh Nun Zayin, this was established, the Friedrich Rebbe, as the Rebbe Rashab later would tell him that his nesiyah should be b'chesed v'rachamim because of the great challenges that would be coming. In 1920, that led to the arrest in Tafresh Pei Zayin and so on, required such an attitude. That attitude of a Rebbe that simply would not accept defeat or failure as an option. It just was not possible. In his attitude with his captors, with all the dangers that he put himself. I mentioned a number of times that such a moving story when the Friedrich Rebbe comes to America. In America, he gets off the boat on Tes Oder, Tovshin, Oder Sheni, and he wants to say a few words when he gets to the Greystone Hotel, and everyone thought he would want to rest. The Rebbe Friedrich Rebbe was not well. The Friedrich Rebbe had been tortured. He'd suffered greatly. He was in a wheelchair. You could see it in the video. And yet he wanted to say a few words. I heard from eyewitnesses that were there, the 20, 30 people that were there, the Rebbe Friedrich Rebbe spoke like he was speaking to millions of people with an attitude that we're going to conquer America. I didn't come here to save my life. I came here because God sent me here, not where I wanted to be, to come show that we can in America build a world exactly as it was in the Alter Heim, that there'll be children running around with tzitzis and beards and sheitlach and so on. Obviously not as children with the sheitlach, but as they grow up, it'll be a community, a Chassidic community, a Frumma community, and so on. And he spoke in a way, we'll build Talmud Teiris, and there'll be Altaras HaKedish. That type of confidence. Afterwards, the Friedrich Rebbe writes in his memoirs, in his diary, he writes that a few of the Chassidim that were there, his closest friends, asked to speak to him. They came to the Friedrich Rebbe, and they said to him, Rebbe, because we love and we respect you and the covet of you and your holy father and your holy grandfather and your holy great-grandfather, all the Rabbeim, we want to tell you that what you're saying is impossible. Don't build your expectations, because it's not possible that this will happen. And when they left, Friedrich Rebbe writes, you could imagine the tears that came out of my eyes the first night on the American soil of Amerikaner Boden. Friedrich Rebbe, thank God, did not listen to them, because Kiseitzel Mechama Alevecha, there's no such thing as a challenge that cannot be overcome. You need inspiration dealing with your personal challenges. You may feel down, depressed, may have challenges in marriage, challenges with your children, challenges in your own internal life. Just look, study the story of the Friedrich Rebbe, starting from when he from the beginning of his life, Tofresh Nun Zayin, but then going forward through his whole Nesias. And of course, study the Rebbe. The people who led the way, there was no such thing as impossible. There was no such thing as failure. It was not an option. That's the attitude that they instilled and imbued into each one of us. And that lesson is the most important lesson of all lessons when you're dealing with any type of chassidus applied. You can learn chassidus from today till tomorrow. If it doesn't affect that type of confidence that you're going as a shliach of the Rebbe, a shliach of the Eibishter, to conquer the world, how can you deal with a world of 7 billion people with trends and cultures and standards that are far, far antithetical to anything that the Torah stands for? How's that possible? Because you're going with keiches that are higher than your own. We're standing as midgets on the shoulders of giants. And we know kiseitzel l'molcham. You're going out. You're going out with the kavona to make a diriba tachtenim. Dafkin tachtenim she'en tachten l'matim menu. It's all planned. It was all predestined that we go into a world that's moli klippas v'sitra achre, filled with darkness, filled with challenges, our personal ones, our collective ones. And you have all the power you need to deal with, do whatever you have to accomplish. All to the ultimate goal, of course, which is the end goal that the Rebbe established, the Geula itself, Amitis Vashlema. So with that, let us move into a follow-up to mental illness discussion and go a little deeper into it from the point of view of Chassidus. And I'll read firstly a few follow-up questions, and then I'll get to... So what exactly is mental illness according to Chassidus? Medicine has its theories. Today's scientific research suggests multiple interlinking causes that affect mental health. These include genetics, environment, and lifestyle, stress and trauma, and of course, biochemical processes and circuits, what is often called chemical imbalances, as well as basic brain structure. But since God created the mind and the emotions, how did the cosmic engineer craft the human brain? And what are the underlying spiritual causes for a mental or emotional imbalance? Now, one in five adults experiences a mental health condition every year. One in 20 lives with a serious mental illness such as schizophrenia or bipolar disorder. So clearly, the Torah, and of course Chassidus, has something to say about this. Even though you're not going to find in Shulchan Aruch, I mean, you have concepts of how you deal with people who have these type of situations and challenges, but analysis doesn't seem to be obvious in any open, overt way in Torah. But how is it possible that the Torah does not address something so fundamental? It does, in Kabbalah and Chassidus, but you have to derive from it. Because the Torah in general talks about Odom Yosher Helich, goes initially with what a healthy person is like, and then tells us how we should avoid unhealthy behaviors and how we should embrace positive reinforcement and positive ways to grow. But then there are situations that are not up to us. Things that happen either, as I said, through genetic, through chemical, through life experiences. Now, I'm not here to go and analyze each case by case because every one of them has to be analyzed. And I want to begin with a very important disclaimer. The Torah says, Nitna Rishus L'Refa L'Rapis. Anything I will be saying now does not in any way, God forbid, compromise that. The Torah says when there's a problem in a medical area, in a health area, whether it's physical health or mental health, there's doctors for this. They're professionals. And you have in the Rebbe's letters, obviously, finding people, especially when it comes to mental and emotional issues, people who have Yerushamayim, or at least respect Yerushamayim, who are experts in their fields, because God blessed them with the power and the insight to be able to help us deal with any given psychiatric or psychological situation. But that still doesn't mean that there isn't much to be learned from Torah and Chassidus on this matter. And actually, what I'm going to be saying now, I believe, can actually be the beginning of a revolution. And the revolution is this, that if we could put together the minds of top professionals who study neuroscientists, psychologists, psychiatrists, people who study the field of mental health, emotional health, and so on, together with the best minds who learn Torah and Chassidus, you absolutely come away with breath, with no question, unprecedented solutions and interventions that we don't have until this point. You know, today generally, the belief is that you have to have a combination of medication in some situations, plus therapy. Different forms of therapy, as every generation, every time period has its own theories on the matter. But there's much to be learned what Chassidus and Kabbalah have to say. So where do we learn about this? And I'll just share a small overview, which is quite fascinating, about how Torah looks at the brain, the human brain and the human mind, and of course the emotions that are part of who we are. Now we all know that everybody's familiar with the 10 spheres that are Nishtal Shlo Mehen, from the 10 spheres evolve the human faculties, as he says in Tanya, 3 Chabad, the 3 cognitive faculties, and the 7 emotional. So clearly he talks about cognitive and emotional. But to understand any type of mental health challenges, you have to go a little deeper into what is the way Torah and Chassidus talk about the mind and how it works. So where's the source for most of it? Most of it is, interestingly, some of it is in Zohar, which is somewhat cryptic, but in Arizal, especially in Eitz Chaim, he talks a number of places how the mind works. And I'll just use a few terms and explain it in simple English. In Chassidus, you have the expression koyach hamaskil. The seichel. Seichel is intelligence. Even if you're right now actively not thinking of an idea, but you have an intelligence going on in your mind, you're aware of it. And you can retrieve, just like on a hard drive, you can retrieve ideas that you thought about yesterday, 2 days ago, and we have in our brain stored a whole bunch of information. However, through effort, we can actually draw new ideas into our systems through what's called the koyach hamaskil. The koyach hamaskil is the power to conceive of ideas. Think of it like a collective unconscious type of reservoir of all, not ideas per se, because there's no ideas there, but the ability to generate intelligence from a place that's beyond intelligence. What we call the bridge between the unconscious and the conscious. I'll use a better word than unconscious, superconscious. Psychology, especially Freudian, talks unconscious, subconscious. Let's talk about superconscious, which is, of course, higher than the conscious. Conscious is what you're aware of, but the superconscious is what you're beyond you. What is it in Lashon of Kabbalah? Keser. Chochmah is where the first spark of an idea comes from. Where does that spark come from? We say koyach ma. It comes somewhere from keser. So in Eitz Chaim, in different sections, especially Shar Memalef, where he talks about keser, and other places, there's the language you hear, Eisi, is the words called moiche gluya, that's conscious wisdom, and moiche stema, concealed mind, which is essentially similar to the koyach hamaskil. In Ayin Beis, where he elaborates on this, especially chapters Reish, Chav, Gimel, and on in Ayin Beis. Actually, no, I should say Peter Kuf Tzadik Vav. My mistake, Kuf Tzadik Vav, 196 and on, and then 23 and on, discusses Meiches Tema in two ways. That the superconscious has one, which is a type of superconscious state from which the conscious mind can have access to. Think of it something that's concealed, what he calls a helem, only compared, it's concealed compared to the conscious. And then there's a deeper level of meiches tema, which is called helem ha'atzmi. It's fundamentally concealed, you can never access it. Why is this so relevant? Because when you want to understand the human mind and how we work as human beings, you have to think of it like this. I'll just use an example, my own example. Think of a reservoir of water. I mentioned reservoir. From where that water draws through mains, into the cities where we dwell. And from those mains come pipes that enter into each home. And there it breaks down into the pipes that go to your sink, to your shower, to other places that where you use water. What is that? It's a much narrower pipe till it comes to a point of a faucet. And you use the faucet, you turn on the faucet, and water comes out from the faucet. Why do you need all that? Because if the water would just rush through it all, we would flood the homes and we wouldn't be able to access and use it in any productive way. So you need the flow of water, you need it, but you need to regulate it and you need to gauge it, that it should flow in the proper fashion. If the faucet breaks, then you have a leak, or you have worse, it can start flooding and so on. The same thing is with the mind. The way God created existence, he created a body we'll call the superconscious, superconscious state of intelligence. Without going into a whole analysis of what that looks like, obviously we're not conscious of it, but it exists. From there will come so-called pipes that will go into the next level of superconscious, which is like, think of it like right before it comes to the faucet. And when you turn on the faucet through effort, you sit down to with your gear, or you sit down to you study to resolve a problem, what happens is the faucet allows from the superconscious a very narrow flow, which is called chokhmah, a spark of an idea, like a drop of water that comes out from the faucet. Once you have it, you can develop it into bina and das, and it comes a full-fleshed idea, which then in turn can also give birth to emotions and feelings. But this is critical of how the balance is necessary here. Let us say you didn't have that flow, meaning that regulated flow. If the superconscious would just suddenly open up its channels, what would happen? It would just turn a person into a madman, because the flow would be so quick and so fast, we wouldn't be able to contain it. That's why they say there's a very thin line between madness and genius, because the connection to that source of superconscious is actually can be destructive if you don't have a structured way of understanding it. Think of it, and let's think of it in terms of trauma. A person, God forbid, goes through a very traumatic experience. No one should know of it. At that moment, they're completely shocked. Their whole system is shocked. What happens? Like it says, "Mishtaki chalibe." Person slowly forgets trauma after 11 months, after 12 months. That is a blessing, that forgetfulness. Because if you had that same intensity, that flow, that channel, that the memory was exactly as strong as it was the first moment, we would never be able to go on with our lives. So it's critical that we're able to just store things away in different compartments, you can say, in the mind, and only have a very strictly a trickle, a flow, that's gauged and regulated for us to be able to survive. If our mind suddenly opened up and every idea and every experience, positive and negative, would some come flowing into your consciousness, we wouldn't be able to handle it. What science calls it today, they call that a chemical imbalance, that there are chemicals that keep these compartments functioning. And when there's a breakdown of these compartments, what happens is you suddenly can have negative thoughts that you can't get rid of, that can lead to paranoia. You could have thoughts of depressing thoughts. The lack of balance. When you see anyone that's in a depressed state and you tell them, but I understand you have challenges in your life, but there are also good things. Why is it that they can't compartmentalize and say, you know what, I have negative things? Like we say, tki betkia da, you have the chedva, and betkia da, you have b'chia, you have chedva simcha, and then there's in another section, another compartment, you have something that is sad. As Rashi brings at the end of Parsha Bereshis. Why can't they compartmentalize? Because the compartments are broken down. And what's rushing into their minds is like a unregulated flow without a faucet to control it. Not trying to oversimplify it, but it's an example. Now, this is taken long before they had the concept of chemical imbalances. This idea existed. And when you look in this Svarim, especially in Kabbalah, it talks about these type of scenarios of how that flow has to be regulated. And actually people who are Eluyim, geniuses, for some reason that flow is broader by them, either through Yegiyah or through Kabbalah Sela, as he explains in Samach Vav, that opens up channels. But if it opens them too much, it can overwhelm and suddenly cause what we would call a state of insanity. Now, obviously this has to be applied in each given situation, because there's a very big difference between schizophrenia and bipolar and other borderline disorder and other personality disorders, but they all come down to an imbalance in that flow. Another thing you could throw into this discussion is Toyu and Tikkun. We hear in Toyu the concept of Shvidus HaKelim. What does that mean? Obviously, it's not a physical thing. It means there's an overwhelming amount of energy and a few containers to contain it. So that too, Chochmah of Toyu and Bina of Toyu, though the Shvidah doesn't really happen in Meichin, as Kabbalah explains, but there's already an imbalance. So another way of looking at imbalance and dysfunctional mind at work, and same thing with emotions, when there's an imbalance, is a toyu diku type of model, as opposed to a tikkun diku model, where you have kelim rechavim, you have expansive containers, and lesser energy. And then as you expand the containers, the energy can flow, can grow. But it has to be commensurate. You cannot overwhelm a child with brilliant ideas, just like you can't overwhelm a child with emotions. Why is a child not capable of intimacy or of deep emotional experiences? Because it's too intense, and they don't have the containers yet. So essentially, the entire concept of mental health has a model and a map that Kabbalah and Chassidus can help us understand it. Now, I would not suggest that any of us can from that derive the medical intervention. That's why I said at the outset, and I say it again, if we can join forces with people who have that experience, because essentially in the secular world, who have the know-how and the refil rapis, and combine it with the knowledge of how the Torah maps, the Kabbalah maps the mind, the superconscious, and the conscious, and how that affects emotions and so on, we could have, in my opinion, not a question, revolutionary new interventions and new approaches to dealing with mental health and so on. Now, how does it help us understand all, us personally understand this all? Understanding this, how does this help us? It helps us understand to get rid of the stigma around this. You know, it is God. And again, I'm talking about God sent, God forbid, illnesses. We're not talking about something that's man-made, which we'll discuss in a moment. When a person has, either through genetic or for other reasons, an impact on their mental stability, this is not something that we have to look at, oh, wow, this is something that we have to avoid. If that's the reality, then you have to see it as basically an imbalance of Eris and Kalim. And that doesn't mean there shouldn't be intervention. We don't just dismiss it into an Eris and Kalim issue. But it's a way of understanding that that person also has a superconscious, and on the contrary, their superconscious may be even more accessible because they don't have the compartments completely there. So in a way, that state of flow is far more bligvul, except it's not, it doesn't work in a world of gvul. In a world where you need structure, where you need the faucets and the pipes to bring it to each particular situation, that's what's lacking. Like it says in Chassidus about Loshen Saginor, and the question is asked, Loshen Saginor is an expression you use, but Loshen Saginor means abundant light. So like saying, when someone's blind, you call them Saginor. So Loshen Saginor, like so-called tongue-in-cheek. So the question is asked, what's that? That's like, that's Leig L'Rosh. That's embarrassing. What, you're calling somebody that is blind, has a lot of light, sees more than everybody. That's an insulting way. So Chassidus explains, not the case. It's taka the truth. A blind person has too much light. The problem is they don't have the filters, and the layers have been either burned out or whatever, have been compromised. So it's not allowing the filters to be able to see something. Seeing something is not just seeing white light. It's also having the shades and the filters that allow us to see the nuances that define vision. So the fact of the matter is that sometimes when you say special children or special energies, that's not just a nice cute line. It's actually the case that they have abundant energies, but their kalim are too weak. So they need intervention, but it's a different way of looking at the dignity of a human being when you think of it in that fashion. And knowing that their soul is always intact. Now, I will discuss more of this just simply because of time limits, because there's the whole discussion of Chassidus, how it goes, the etzem ha-nefesh of every person, whether it's a person who's blind, God forbid, or handicapped in another way, or mentally or emotionally challenged, the nefesh is always neshama shenasata b'taherihi. So the question is, where exactly has it been compromised? So we know there's keiches, there's nefesh, nesu keiches. Then there's keiches haklulim benefesh. There's nefesh keiches atzmim, keiches hiyulim, keiches pnimim, keiches nalomim, and keiches gluim. So understanding these levels of how from the soul travels into the pipes till it comes a revealed and conscious faculty is critical also in this whole discussion. So that part I'll leave for a next episode. But I just wanted to describe that there's a map for these things in Torah and Chassidus, in Kabbalah and Chassidus, that part of it, that maps out, of course, the mind, which is, of course, created by Tzelem Elokim in the divine image, like the God's mind, so to speak. God's mind, as he chose to manifest himself in Chochmah, in Bina, and, of course, in Kesed, which is Meches Timah. Okay. So, dear Rabbi Jacobson, continuing this theme, thank you so much for working on this Meaningful Life project. I don't get to listen to all your classes, but that might start to change. Mental health became a big part of my life when I was 17 years old. However, as much as it was for me, it was incredibly more difficult for my older brother, who was diagnosed with a form of schizophrenia. Being a devoted sibling and a loving brother, I put a lot of my time energy and love into our relationship. In the beginning, when I first found out, I said, no way. I was denying this reality. However, as time went on and I started seeing different behavior and even sharing real conversations with my brother about what was happening in his life, I've adjusted to this truth and try to help him in any way I can. He feels my kind of help is hurting him. A complex issue, to say the least. However, his life is in jeopardy and decisions must be made to help him. The weight I am carrying as a brother is very difficult for me. As well, my wife is being affected by his presence. I was having a hard time with really understanding him and how to deal with him frequently coming over. The responsibilities that I had up until recently was too much. Currently, I have not seen him since 2 months ago. Thank God he's fine, and I found out from different sources. My questions are, what am I supposed to do when my brother comes over to my house and puts down and blames a fellow family member whom I love dearly? What are some ways to help my brother come to terms with his current state of health? Or is there a way to heal this type of illness? Do you know of any Jewish support groups in New York? Did I make the right decision by not arranging a place for my brother to sleep after his second relapse? My thoughts were I would not be helping him, rather it would just set him up for a relapse. I know I have more questions. That's it for now. Thank you for everything. Well, if a schizophrenia is the issue, number one, first and foremost, you don't mention it, is there a doctor involved? You have to have a professional involved. This is not a small matter. Schizophrenia is a very serious illness, very dangerous one, without going into all the details. So I am not in a position, I'm not a doctor. My advice, not just advice, I would say, I insist, you have to go to a doctor, and I hope there is one involved here. A person like this needs medical care. This is no different than someone, God forbid, has cancer or has diabetes or some other illness. It's a different sort. You need professionals that deal with this. In addition to that, obviously, the Torah has much to say about betochen, about trust. So I don't think you should take it as a brother, your responsibility of how to figure out where he should be living and so on. It has to be done as a family decision by consultation with the doctors, and more than one if preferable. As far as how to deal with him as he comes to your house, look, in all situations like this, you always try to be kind and courteous. But if he says things that are insulting, you have to be able to say to a person like that, and not try to patronize and say it's not appropriate what you're saying. And no matter what he says, you have to protect the innocent around. And if he can't control himself, maybe he shouldn't be coming over. Again, this should be done in consultation with professionals. And in general, talking about from a Torah and Chassidus point of view, obviously we always have to be kind, especially if it's our own family members. As I said last week, the key thing is not to run away due to the stigma and due to our own discomfort and shame and pride. We have to look at it, take the bull by the horns, the people who are responsible, parents and so on, take the person to a professional, get a diagnosis, and do the best we can do. Because the collateral damage is always worse than the original. You can contain it, you're always in a better situation. Going back to what I said earlier about, in general, mind, mental health and how the mind works, schizophrenia is definitely part of the issues of a serious imbalance where the mind that God created, the flow, is not proper and therefore creates hallucinations and all the other things that the delusional elements that schizophrenia, hearing voices, can create. There's actually a letter from the Rebbe, a tzettel from the Rebbe that I want to bring in because I think it's very interesting. And it also has to be read with a proper way, and I wanted to explain it because people have asked me about it, and I'm using this opportunity to explain. So this is printed in volume, I believe it's volume 27, of the Igros Kedush of the Rebbe. It's a letter from tzettel from Yud Gimel Kislev Tovshin Lamed Beis. And the Rebbe says, he's writing to someone who writes about schizophrenia, that diuk ba'anochas tefillin, that there should be emphasis on putting on tefillin for those that need a blessing and their parents. And the Rebbe says, and there's a shaykhs, direct shaykhs between tefillin and this illness. And it's like mida keneged mida. Schizophrenia, the Rebbe writes, whatever should be the cause of it, meaning the medical cause, what is its inyan? I hasama bein ametzias da hasviva kamoishi lekamoish achel rei v'tefesesa b'stichle. That it's a distortion, a inconsistency, an imbalance between reality and the way the ill person, the schizophrenic, sees and experiences this reality in his mind. That's, and the Rebbe says, regardless what the cause is, ubamela one nailed etzle midis masimis l'riyah sechel zu. So that this gives birth, therefore, to feelings and emotions that are consistent to his distorted view of pachat, fear, paranoia, yira, shereitzim laziki, that people want to cause damage to him, people want to hurt him, and so on. Two, that it causes changes from one extreme to other in his mood swings, from fear that's not based on any reality, to suddenly to a very high state of euphoric state that doesn't have any basis as well. Now this, the truth is, that second point also is a symptom of bipolar. Pitzel ha-nefesh v'hashkofa. And therefore creates also this type of, basically a dichotomy in his entire way of looking at things. Tefillin, the Rebbe says, chilik ma-mitzvah v'sgulosa. Part of the mitzvah and its features and its power and its virtues, sgulosa, its strengths, its powers. L'shabat ha-lev, to bind the heart and the emotions and the mind, l'lekim emes, to God that's true, emphasized emes, not a false reality, a distorted one, a delusional one, but emes. Allah of neman ani Hashem leishanisi, the Eibush is leishanisi. There's no change, but meila hasom ben asechel hergish v'amitzias, and therefore has the power to reconcile, or to say to rebalance, to recalibrate the mind, the feeling, and the reality. Now the Rebbe is not negating here going to a doctor, obviously, and that tefillin replaces medication or therapy or other things, that medical interventions. But it's fascinating, based on what I described earlier, that tefillin is essentially a force, and this is discussed in the Maimorim of actually the Bar Mitzvah of the Friedrich Rebbe, tefillin de Mora Alma, based on Maimorim of Yimne Bin and other places, where in Sharat Tefillin, the idea that you're taking tefillin tak it takes, when you put on tefillin, the Eibush is maniach tefillin, and kuchabrichu maniach tefillin, the whole dvart is what kuchabrichu, the two interpretations of Chassidus, how you're drawing down from kuchabrichu into our mechin and midas, as we learn, as we say it in the Maimor of the Bar Mitzvah Maimor that the Bar Mitzvah Bochrim say. So you're seeing that the addition to all the medical, and I say that again and again, there's an understanding on a spiritual level that these inconsistencies are part of the distortions that happen in the world of Tayu, that happen in the transmission from Kesed into Chochmah, from the superconscious into the conscious, and all, of course, the result of the Tzimtzum Harishon, which created the first big quantum leap, or you can say radical leap, the radical distortion, that ultimately can have all types of distortions that exist to the point of real illnesses of this nature. So part of in addition to the medical, which is obvious, you also have the dimensions of tefillin and other things, obviously, that have segulas like this. So this is what I'll suffice with saying with this now. There's more to say on this topic, but I have to move it on to the next episodes. Let me go to another discussion, another topic, make hefsek ben parsha l'parsha. Since this is rolling, I can't stop and pause for too long, but consider that a hefsek. So let's move into criticizing others. Where do we draw the line between the mitzvah of rebuking your neighbor and inappropriately criticizing others? The mitzvah of hechiyach techiyas samisecha. Why are people mixing into other people's business? I've been to several homes where the topic of conversations is the Shabbos table, and the presence of all the kids is not in the parsha or chassidish story or hergish, feeling, but about the flaws of others. Can you please address this and its negative effects? Question three, we're always talking about others and what they should be doing. Lots of slandering is going on in our communities. How can I combat this, at least in my own sphere of influence? Okay, well, I think it goes without saying that one of the worst possible things, Lashon Hara, Mitzvah Shemra, gossip, slander, and all the thing that goes into that category. It's number one, the Gemara says, three people are killed through it, as it says in Chassidus, na yem yem. The person who speaks it, the person who listens to it, and the person who's spoken about. Without going into the discussion, reasons for that. It's one of the worst possible things. Sinas chinam is the cause of the Beis HaMikdash, Churban Beis HaMikdash. Avas chinam is the antidote. So to have to elaborate is needless and unnecessary, but sometimes it has to be stated that this is something that has to be completely cleansed in our homes, in our tables, especially our children. I say especially. It shouldn't be existent at all. But everyone has control of what's discussed at their dinner table, at their morning table, at their Shabbos table. And simply unacceptable. There's no way, this is absolutely unacceptable. Even if a husband and wife want to talk about something that may be relevant in a positive way, even that should not be done in front of children. So I think that every person should make that achlota right now, Chedesh El, going into the year Tovshinai Vov, the time has come to simply eradicate this in our homes and in our communities as much as possible. At the end of the day, everything starts in your home. You have control there. What happens in the street, you can't control, but you can control what's in your home. So it should be zero tolerance of this, but zero tolerance starts with the adults. Shouldn't be doing this. This is a single thing that you can do immediately to help your children grow into healthier adults. People ask for things that they can do. Here's something you can do immediately. That's above all. Regarding the issue of chiyach techiyach, so there's halachas about this. There's hayros plentiful from the rabbeim, and especially in our day and age, we've been told that the approach with nails, as the Friedrich Rebbe says, should be used on yourself, not on others. That's the approach. Rebuke, chiyach techiyach, is reserved, number one, when it's pure intent, when the person you're speaking to, you have a relationship with that they'll listen to you. I've told the story of the Rabbi Shalom Ben Gordon a number of times from the Turkish bath, that the first thing you do is you warm somebody up, then you elevate them and warm them even more, and then they ask you, the Friedrich Rebbe told them, they pay you, they ask you to rebuke them, to slap them with eucalyptus leaves. The lesson from the Turkish bath and how to speak to people who have grime in their lives. And we, especially today, where it's so much tenekesh and nishbu, children who are captives, not children, whether it's children in age or children in yediyas and knowledge, the approach is generally asetev, positive reinforcement, positive expectations, empowering, elevating, and so on. Hechich techiach is a mitzvah, but there are conditions how, and if there's a suffix, it's always best to go lekula, meaning not to rebuke, but to go with a positive approach. If you want to know the line between the two, well, the line I would say is until you're a place where you can really feel that you have the Yiras Shamayim and the level of purity that you will be listened to, not just to vent and not just to express. So much of it comes from a negative place where we're criticizing others. I don't think I have to explain how much most critique you hear has nothing to do with looking for what's really good. It's a person's own issues, their own bitterness, their own judgmentalism, things that are completely not chassidus, not teira, and it's something that has to be completely eliminated, to be very honest. And we know from the rabbeim the approach, always chiyuv, always chiyuv. You have a situation where somebody trusts you, where they are coming to you, and you know that they could listen, and you need to say something stronger, fine, that's a particular circumstance, and you need to make sure that's a true circumstance. But beyond that, I would basically say criticizing others is not our mission in this world. Our mission in this world is to empower people. If somebody is doing something that's destructive, you can have some influence, by all means. If you can't, move away from it and stay away from the whole situation. That's the general approach. Someone writes actually a story that happened that with Rabbi Kohos Weiss, who drove the Rebbe to camp the first time he went to camp from Pittsburgh. He was in Pittsburgh. He said that a chosid, name the Rebbe, a chosid thinks about egen chesenis and yenim's milas. Thinks about his own faults and someone else's milas. Like this with the negel, using nails, looking at others with a right eye. If you want to be critical of yourself. And unless a person is ready to do that, I don't think they have the credibility and the honesty and integrity to be able to criticize others. Okay. And the way we affect the world, our community, is by first affecting ourselves. If every one of us makes this achlota and does what we have to do, then there's no one to slander with because the person wants to talk to you gossip, you're not interested in listening. What will remain? Those few people, isolated, who insist, that'd be their problem. If every one of us does not participate, so you can imagine what the results will be. That's the way you change things. I don't know if you can change it globally from the top. You change it from the bottom, from the grassroots of what you talk about, what's in your conversation. Be careful. Someone goes over to you. I know it's very tempting. People love to hear something about another person. And you say, you know something? I'm not interested. Talk to someone else about it. Or don't talk at all about it, which is really the better response. But I'm not interested in it. If there's no participants, there's no room for this. You know, there are things in life that will happen whether we could like it or not. But this is completely controlled by what we talk about. Us, you and I, and everyone around us. Moving right along, let's go to the next topic, which is something about Kabbalah sale follow-up. Last week's question of Chassidus was about Kabbalah sale. So here's what someone wrote. Just to add to the subject, it appears to me the question last week was, what's the difference between Kabbalah sale, Mesiras Nefesh, and what was the third thing? Kabbalah sale, Mesiras Nefesh, and Iskafia. So he says, so just to add to the subject, it appears to me that the question of Kabbalah sale has sense that doing Kabbalah sale is has sense that doing Kabbalah sale is to be doing Iskafia. And this, I think, is a mistake emerging from how many of us were raised. Tanya Perek Memalev says that the upleg of Kabbalah sale, which means the hanocha, the axiom, needs to be ever present, whether a person is in a state of enthusiasm or devotion or reverence or neither. Kabbalah sale is not necessarily about breaking yourself. Even though, as discussed in the first few episodes of this series, some of us were raised that Kabbalah sale was only about breaking us, either us breaking ourselves or our teachers breaking us. Rather, it is a stance of God consciousness or conscientiousness. What this stance does for us depends on where we stand. Correct. For some, it requires using Iskafi at certain times. For others, at a later stage in progress, it becomes only natural to do the right thing, even when not in the mood, because God is present. So, well put. I think I said more or less last week this, but maybe this is spelled out a little more. Kabbalah sale is a state. It's exactly a state of being, a noun. Whereas Iskafi is an act. That it can be an outgrowth of Kabbalah sale, but it's an act, how you act in particular conditions. But Kabbalah sale, even if you're doing Ishapcha, you need Kabbalah sale. Kabbalah sale is, wherever you're doing, Kabbalah sale is always the foundation. Iskafi is one mode, one method of how you refrain from certain temptations or refrain from certain behavior and so on and so forth. Okay. Moving along, here is another question. Rabbi Jacobson, after listening to 80 inspiring episodes of My Life, I would like to begin studying Chassidus. Please guide me on how to do it. Which maimer should I start with? Can you please provide guidance on how to study Chassidus and really understand it? You're an inspiration. Thank you very much. Why it took 80 episodes, I'm not sure. But you know, better late than never. And I commend you. I feel honored that I was able to be a catalyst somewhat for you to wanting to learn Chassidus. So if you've listened to these episodes, you'll know one bottom line, underlying principle. I'm starting with how to learn Chassidus. You have to start with a certain muskladishin, an axiom, a given. Chassidus was written for you, and you alone. Forget about everybody else. Just like the Matan Torah, everybody heard Lashon Yachid, Anochi Hashem Elokecha. They heard the God speaking directly to them. Not as a group, not as a community, an individual. First thing you have to know that the Rabbeim spent most of their lives writing Chassidus, starting from Tanya, for you and I to apply it to our lives, to the challenges that we have. So a simple question you have to ask yourself. I have this and this issue today. I feel down. I feel depressed. I'm not driven. I'm not motivated. I have dilemmas. Say, the Rabbeim have answers for me. How do I find those answers? If you go with that attitude, you're already halfway there. Then you may need somebody to help you interpret that maimer to apply it. But you have to ask that question and go with absolute confidence. If you have a doubt that Chassidus maybe doesn't have an answer, obviously you're not going to find it. So the first thing is that's the attitude. Where to begin? So there are several letters from the Rebbe when he gave different hadrachah. It's obviously b'makom shalibei chafetz. It's a very critical component in learning is to learn something with your heart desires, because then you learn it with more passion and more commitment. But within that context, very often what's suggested is to begin with derech mitzvusecha. I don't know your age. I'm not sure where your life status is. But I would suggest Derech Mitzvasecha, Mitzvahs Avos Yisrael is a very good beginning because it gives a good foundational element to what souls are like and our connection. But there are other mitzvahs, Tzitzis, Mitzvahs Binyan Migdash, Minei Melech, Masar and Bekosov. These are a few fundamentals in Derech Mitzvasecha. There are some Amorim and Lekut Teira as well that are very fundamental. But I would begin with these Derech Mitzvasecha ones, and if you finish with those, then move on. The most important thing is to learn something that you really enjoy. And I say enjoy, but your Nefesh HaBahamis should enjoy it. It should be relevant. You should feel that it's speaking to you, that it resonates. That's the most important thing of all, whatever it is that you learn. Obviously, there's Parokim and Tanya that are very fundamental as well. But I've discussed Techum Tzasecha based on some letters from the Rebbe. And I may use this opportunity. If anyone out there has, a Mashpiim or anyone, a specific directive that you've seen from the Rebbe or from the Rabbeim, what to learn or your own experience, I would love you to send me a list of what you think is a good, for many people at least. You know, it's a kol chad v'chad lefum shiurid delay. Every person according to his needs. But in general, what type of like regimen or curriculum of Maimorei Chassidus would you suggest for most people? And I will share that with the public, so to l'te'el es hatzibur. I would really appreciate that. You could send it again to our forum, meaningfullife.com/mylife. Okay. Let's now move on to the question, of Chassidus question of this week, and then to the essays. What is the Chassidus question of the week? How do you explain the Nefesh HaBahamis and the Nefesh Elokis in relevant and contemporary terms? I understood the two to refer mostly to the moral choices we make, like whether to do a mitzvah or commit a sin. Is there more to it than that? Question number two in this vein. I once heard a Tanya class where the esteemed lecturer described the Nefesh HaBahamis as narrow-sighted, selfish, worried. Is this the interpretation everyone holds? Can you describe how the Nefesham is not worried or anxious? It might help me with my anxiety, with the anxiety I'm struggling with. Okay. So briefly, when you look in Tanya, chapter 9, and I go straight to chapter 9, where he describes the anatomy of the animal soul, Nefesh HaBahamis, and the divine soul, Nefesh Elokis, he says that one resides in the mind and one in the heart. Where the mind is a reflective mind, and the heart is a impulsive heart. And just as the blood of the heart nourishes the mind, the brain, the same thing is the emotions and their impulses can also travel to the mind. And that's called sheichid. Sheichid ya'avr eine chacham. He doesn't bring that there, but it means it blinds us and turns us into subjective creatures where your mind suddenly is justifying your emotional impulses. So you see from that that Nefesh Elokis, Nefesh HaBahamis is a lot more broader than just doing a mitzvah or not doing an aveda. It's how you run your life. Who's in control? Who's the captain of the ship? Moyach Shalat al-Alev, as he explains then in Perek Yud Beis and on, is the idea that your reflective mind does not let the impulses and the spontaneity of the heart to control you. Someone calls you up on a phone, a telemarketer, and they make a very good pitch to sell you something. And it's very hard to say no. It's very appealing. You don't want to say no. They know how to manipulate you. And so here's a perfect example. You can apply this principle to a very neutral, not even a kedusha area. If your heart is going to be the one that responds, you'll just say, okay, I'll do it already. And then you find out you bought a piece of junk, wasted money. If your mind will say, let me think about it. You tell the person, can you call me back tomorrow? I'll think about it. Their answer will always be, this offer expires tonight. Because they understand the power of impulse. They want to get you on your impulse. Because that's when you're weak. That's when you're vulnerable. So a very simple example. In life, all the time, decisions are made. Most mistakes. Someone insults you. You right away react. Sleep on it. Think about it. You can always react tomorrow. Many times you get an email, and you right away type up a quick answer. It's happened to everyone, to myself as well. And then you say, you know what? I have my answer. Let me see. Let me wait till tomorrow. And often, as the anger abates, you realize, you know something? Maybe not the wisest thing to respond. So the mind is essentially like a wise counselor going to a lawyer, which is within you, your mind, the shaftim within your mind, and reviewing, is it appropriate to react like this or to react like that? Now, obviously, there are times where you need to follow your impulse if, God forbid, there's danger, crisis, immediate. But a person who's generally an intelligent person, the captain of the ship should be your mind, and then it leads you to your emotions. You go on a date. So right away, you like the person you see. But your mind tells you, one second, I have to find out more about this person. It doesn't take away that your emotions will come into play when necessary. So in general, psychological perspective, the psychological control of your life is a mind-heart relationship. And that's really the Nefesh Elokis and Nefesh HaBahamis in the broadest sense of the word. Of course, it applies to the most important thing of all, which is our mission in our lives. Where the Nefesh Elokis keeps you on track, this is what God wants of you, this is how you fulfill your calling. And Nefesh HaBahamis is interested in its own needs and survival. The Nefesh Elokis is transcendent in nature, like the Neir, Hashem Nishmas Adam, looking to reach upward. The Behemoth looks downward, looking for survival and taking care of its own needs. But the root of how they function is based on that principle. So this is one way to make it relevant. More to say about this, obviously. And as far as the interpretation is narrow-sighted, selfish, worried, I wouldn't define the Nefesh HaBahamis as such. You can say the emotions that are impulsive can be narrow-sighted, selfish, and worried because it's very myopic and just looks at the immediate here and now like an animal may look at. And the mind has a more expansive nature that's able to look at different perspectives, be patient, be deliberate, and so on. So that's how I would explain this. Okay. We'll conclude with the three essays of this week. As I said, we continue the top 90 essays, coming close to finishing those 90. All wonderful essays. In this case, three, the first one in Hebrew, about conviction, by Ben Sion Butman, age 32, a shliach, in, of all places, Phnom Penh, Cambodia. So even in Cambodia, a shliach participated. That alone should win an award. So this is a Hebrew one about conviction. It talks about shichnua atzmi, which in Hebrew is, there's an expression, there's a school of thought in the 20th century, 19th century, that talked about auto-suggestion, where how you train yourself to take an attitude to something, and that alone you can like psych yourself into a particular state of mind. So he makes the case here in this essay, how this is really pre the conceivers of it in our modern times, is really based on Torah. And he brings a maimer in Oz Yosher, Tofresh Ayin, where he bases this essay on, where he talks about how a person can control their lives. The confidence by simply knowing that you have within your spirit and your soul the ability to achieve something. That idea in Hedegesh has a direct impact on a person. And he explains that maimer in a very nice practical application, which applies to all given situations, whatever comes your way, that you're able to deal with the challenges in this particular fashion. And I'm just looking here to read. Oh, he brings Rabbi Akiva as a working model. Rabbi Akiva, who was age 40, born Ben Gedim or Ger, and did not know a word of Torah. And of course, he learned the lesson from the drops of water on the stone. But it's a lesson of a person who discovered a deeper strength and essentially convinced himself, because it was so easy to argue that I'm not capable of starting anew at age 40. And yet he was able to do so. And he elaborates that as the working model based on that maimon in Tofrei Shayin. He also brings it into a bunch of case studies from Chassidus about how to look at things in a positive way. The idea of taking on resolutions, even if you don't feel you're capable, like the Rebbe says often, you take on a resolution, the new tzenedus, new channels open up for you. The hashpa that we have, that words have, ideas in Chassidus that talk about how to deal with something when there's a dangerous situation, and it opens up new channels as well. And of course, the story with the wagon driver, the lesson that the Baal Shem Tov and his chassidim learned from the wagon driver, who said he had his wagon was stuck and they didn't want to help him. They said they can't help him. He says, you could, you don't want to. The power of rotzen, ein lecha dover ha'emid b'fnei ha'rotzen, the power of will to control. So it's an interesting, which can use a lot more development, but the premise of it is a very powerful one and definitely worthwhile reading. Essay number two is Establishing a Deep Sense of Identity by Shalom Yunitz, age 31, Jewish preschool rabbi, Mequon, Wisconsin. He begins by saying, one of the major questions in the field of education is whether the teacher puts the focus on the what aspect, the when, the how, or the who. So just as the Chassidic way of living begins with a focus on the who, the internal essence, likewise, is true regarding this educational approach. And he goes into a whole approach how to educate young children, instilling in them a very powerful sense of identity from the moment of birth. And talks about the story of the Rebbe Rashab, how young age he cried when he went into the Tzemach Tzedek, why the Ebeshah doesn't reveal himself to him. And how the Rebbe in Lekutei Sichos, Chelek Tezvav, learns from that a lesson that in our day and age, every child can be taught that type of foundation, and said that there's change. That once the Rebbe Rashab, that story happened with the Rebbe Rashab and was told to us, that opens up a new opportunity that didn't exist before, that a person can, that even a child can have that type of sense of a divine connection. He quotes a sikha from Achron Shapesach Tov Shin Mem Beis, where the Rebbe quotes that, of course, that Mashiach was born right after the Churban. In that case, if Mashiach comes, he's a young child. And Rebbe says that even a young child, when in a healthy situation, can have unbelievable powers, more than we ever can imagine. And the Rebbe applies it to each one, not just to Mashiach or the Rebbe Rashab. He applies it to each one. And in later generations, the Rebbe says, children have more power than they've had previous, which is an interesting point that I've never really seen quite emphasized. And this essay brings it to our attention. Again, a great essay, and he brings it into his own experiences in Mequon, Wisconsin, in the school, of how they teach children when it comes to Yom Tov, how they focus on Chassidus Shemeshes for the Yom Tov Pesach. Last year they chose the value of trust, how they take children every day to shul, and how they focus on davening, learning particular lessons about the Eibishter. And he goes on, he concludes with a very good summary, the right of every child from birth. These are the core beliefs we should have. The right of every child from birth is to be seen as competent to bring their Jewish identity to life from the first breath of air. The way to establish Jewish identity from birth is to see the child as your partner in every Jewish moment. Every question of a child must be met by a dialogic adult who is interested in the child and his question. To believe in a child means to believe in the concept of B'Tselem Elokim. A very good essay, powerful essay, and can definitely be used in many ways. And finally, the third essay is Eliminating Dissonance for a Happier Self by Emmett Gillis, age 25, a history teacher in Dallas, Texas. Again, I'm continuing, always blown away by the diversity of the essay writers, from where they are, their profession, their age. It's amazing what you can accomplish when you apply yourself to applying Chassidus to your life. In this essay, the writer addresses a Chassidic approach to overcome depression, which this writer found effective in struggling with my own feelings of disappointment and inadequacies. And goes through a whole discussion of depression, but then applies Chassidus, that Chassidus' approach is not to avoid the problem and to say it doesn't exist. Because so much of the negative impact of depression is your own sense of lack of self-worth, the demoralization. By understanding that the battle was meant to be this way, and God put us into a world that there'll be struggles, gets rid at least of the tension and the angst and the anxiety that's involved in the mere battle. Because you start thinking, look, I tried this and it didn't really work. As the Alter Rebbe says in a number of places in Tanya, that the battle itself is the kavana, and therefore you shouldn't be depressed by it. So this writer applies this very much into Iskafias, Hapche, the whole methods of Chassidus, into dealing with some difficult emotional situations and challenges that we are in. And that, again, all the essays can be found when you subscribe to our weekly newsletter, which goes every Thursday night, goes out a weekly newsletter. You get the new essays included in there, but they're also posted on our website, meaningfullife.com/mylife/contest. And we'll continue addressing and sharing these essays. Let me conclude as I began. Everyone have a ksiv v'chsim eteva, a chedesh el, a chedesh harachamim. We should do our hachonis for the new year and counting for the past year in the simcha v'tuv levav, all the five rosh hatevas of el. It should be a very blessed year in every possible way. And as we've discussed, when you go in with an attitude, the el dika attitude, ani l'deidi v'deidi li, I am to my beloved is to me. It's out of love. You go with that positive attitude, that itself is the antidote that preempts and prevents so much of the challenges of our times. This has been My Life Chassidus Applied, episode 81. Until next Sunday from 8 to 9 p.m., everyone have a very blessed week.